Good afternoon. The first item of business is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio questions are COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. If any member wishes to seek to ask a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button or enter the letter R in the chat function during the relevant question. And as always, I would make a plea for short and succinct questions and answers to match. Question number one, Finn Carson.
To ask the Scottish Government, as part of the delivery of a cross-government COVID recovery strategy, what effort it is making to ensure the resilience of Scotland's response to any future pandemic?
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, the NHS Recovery Plan sets out key ambitions and actions to be developed and delivered now and over the next 5 years. The Recovery Plan is backed with over £1 billion of targeted investment, which will drive the recovery of our National Health Service not just to its pre-pandemic level but beyond. In addition, the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill will help to build resilience against future public health threats, including any future pandemics. The provisions within Part 1 of the Bill will, if passed, allow Scottish ministers to respond swiftly, flexibly and proportionately to any infection or contamination which presents or could present significant harm to human health.
Finlay Carson.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for his response. As the pandemic thankfully begins to ease, I know that the Scottish Government has been in consultation with various PPE suppliers over the need to stockpile for future pandemics. But concern has been voiced, however, over the huge cost involved in procurement, ultimately being left potentially without update and useless equipment, just as happened the last time. Can I ask that greater consideration should be given to encourage domestic manufacturers like Alpha Solway, based in Dumfries, who make 150,000 respirators a week, and that production could increase to more than 2 million a week, enough to meet the entire needs of the NHS because of its investment in using its own raw materials. Would the Cabinet Minister look into this as a more cost-effective way forward in the long term?
Deputy First Minister.
If my recollection serves me correct, Alpha Solway were providing supplies through the PPE network to the Scottish effort, and I'm very grateful to the employees and the leadership of Alpha Solway for all that they contributed. Obviously, the development of the domestic supply chain in all of these circumstances is very important. It was a key priority of my ministerial colleague, Ivan McKee, who did a tremendous amount of work in dialogue with the business community to enable us to manufacture more and more of the required PPE within Scotland rather than to be relying on imports. So, fundamentally, I agree with Mr Carson about the importance of that point. I think there is an issue which I do need to raise, which is about the question of stockpiling. Because if we stockpile for the possibility of a pandemic, if no pandemic comes, then inevitably there may well be stock that cannot be utilised within particular periods. But efforts are made to recondition that to make sure we maximise the effectiveness and the efficiency of those arrangements. So I would assure Mr Carson that these arrangements are very much at the heart of the pandemic learning that we have undertaken, and we want to certainly encourage that domestic supply chain to its maximum level possible.
Supplementary, Jim Fairley.
Thank you, President Officer. I agree entirely with Finlay Carson that we need to be taking steps now to ensure the resilience of Scotland's response to any future pandemic. But does the Deputy First Minister agree with me that the entire purpose of the COVID Recovery Bill, which the Conservative Party are so vehemently and opportunistically opposing, that's entirely what it's set out to do?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, as I said in my original answer to Mr Carson, the Coronavirus Recovery and Reform Scotland Bill will help to build resilience against future public health threats, so it does need to be taken seriously by Parliament and engaged with seriously, because without those legislative protections in place, the speed of response and the ability for us to respond to the changing dynamics of a pandemic would be limited. So I do encourage members of Parliament to engage constructively with the Government on this bill and produce a statute book which simply brings us into line with powers that have existed in England and Wales for over a decade in relation to pandemic management.
And supplementary, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Culture has been one of the sectors hit hardest by the pandemic. What lesson has the Scottish Government learned from the experience of COVID to help shield the culture sector from the impact of future pandemics?
Obviously, the government has taken action over a range of different sectors, and the culture sector is one, to make sure that we provided the maximum amount of support possible to the sector to enable it to navigate its way through the difficulties, where obviously audiences couldn't be present and artistic performances and other events couldn't take place, and then to be able to deploy that important cultural contribution in the aftermath of the pandemic, when people will perhaps need that even more to recover mentally and socially from the trauma of the pandemic. So the government's funding arrangements were designed to sustain the sector. There is, of course, ongoing funding in the normal budget arrangements that are in place. And I know my colleague, the Culture Minister, Neil Gray, is very actively engaged in dialogue with the cultural sector to maximise its contribution to Scottish society.
Question number two, Alex Rowley, who is not in the chamber. Question number three, Karen Loughan.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how long COVID has been factored into its COVID-19 strategic review.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, our strategic framework update in February 2022 confirmed that ongoing assessments of the COVID-19 threat will combine assessments of potential disease impact and the risk of infection, as well as current and expected infection fatality rates. The assessment of disease impact will consider factors such as long COVID. Accurate data is vitally important in understanding the prevalence of long COVID. Data from the ONS COVID-19 infection survey is currently the best source of evidence on estimated prevalence of long COVID in Scotland. Our Chief Scientist Office is funding 9 Scottish-led research projects with a total funding commitment of £2.5 million to improve understanding of the long-term effects of COVID-19 on physical and mental health, and to help with developing effective clinical interventions to support recovery and rehabilitation.
Carol Mulcahy.
Thank you for that answer. Given the answer, can the Cabinet Secretary explain why the Scottish Government is yet to host a debate on this important issue on the long-term effects of long COVID, and why was the scheduled debate on this issue last week changed to a different topic?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, the Government is committed to having a debate on long COVID, and that will happen very shortly. The issues in relation to the ability of the Government to set out a complete picture of the response, which involves funding announcements, which I think Members of Parliament might object to hearing during the course of a local authority election campaign.
And supplementary, Sandesh Gohani.
Thank you. GP colleagues of mine up and down Scotland despair at the absence of a pathway for long COVID patients, and no one in the comfort of this chamber should pretend that there is. I face patients crying in despair over their long COVID symptoms. My colleagues face patients crying in despair over their long COVID symptoms. But the Scottish Government still does not know how to deal with this, despite the tried and tested models running in Hertfordshire. My question, given over 100,000 Scots now suffer with long COVID and cannot wait for the research that is being told by the Cabinet Secretary that is being performed, when will the Scottish Government realise the devastation wreaking across Scotland and finally start caring for people with long COVID by getting long COVID clinics up and running? Because what is happening now does not work.
Deputy First Minister.
I don't agree with the picture set out by Dr Gulhani, and I don't think it reflects the position that is the intended approach of the National Health Service in Scotland. It is very clear, and the Health Secretary has set this out to Parliament on countless occasions, that the pathway for patients who have long COVID must be assessed by individual clinicians, because there is no way Dr Gulhani can say to me that every long COVID case presents in exactly the same fashion. That would be an absurd clinical proposition to put forward. So individual clinicians must make the assessments of individual patients, and the National Health Service must meet those needs. There are research projects underway, which I would have thought as a clinician, Dr Gulhani might have been interested in hearing what the research projects might produce, rather than rubbishing those research projects. It's a really odd position for a clinician to take, to rubbish evidence gathering as part of the process, so that we can gather the intelligence and the information to enable us to take the right decisions. Now, that strikes me as evidence-led policy making, and if Dr Gulhani, as a Member of Parliament and as a clinician, can't see the benefits of evidence-led policy making, then I think he's got some serious questions to answer.
Question number four, Craig Hoy.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the total costs of the COVID-19 vaccine certification scheme.
Deputy First Minister.
President, so Scotland's COVID certification scheme was an important part of our domestic response to COVID-19, and the app continues to be a vital part of supporting people to travel internationally, as the scheme also provides COVID-19 status. I can confirm that the Scottish Government has directly allocated over £7 million to date. I have asked my officials to place a table of this breakdown in Spice.
Craig Hoy.
So, £7 million wasted by John Swinney on a domestic COVID passport scheme, which was quietly switched off by the SNP government last week. The Deputy First Minister was warned that domestic certification wouldn't work, that it breached data protection laws, would damage business and cost jobs. So will the Deputy First Minister now say sorry to the businesses damaged and for the jobs lost? And will he apologise to the Scottish people for wasting £30,000 a day of their money on his botched scheme?
Deputy First Minister.
What a lot of absolute baloney. And by Mr Hoy's standards, a colossal amount of baloney. Mr Hoy must surely understand the basics of this point, that the COVID status app was necessary, regardless of the domestic application, was necessary to enable people to be able to travel from Scotland to other countries. Surely the Conservatives must understand that point. So the costs that have been incurred are necessary to enable us to produce an app which would allow Scottish people to visit other countries. Now, if the Conservatives are saying to us they didn't want people in Scotland to have an international app that would allow them to travel internationally, well, that's an interesting message. I'd be fascinated to know if any Conservative members have in fact used their app on international travel in the course of the last few weeks and months. That would be a fascinating question to have answered. And as for the government quietly announcing anything about the domestic app, the government published its stance on the domestic app openly and transparently, just like the government does on every occasion about our policy agenda.
And supplementary, Willie Coffey.
Thanks, President Officer. Just given that a number of places still require proof of vaccination before allowing individuals to enter the country, could the Deputy First Minister confirm for us that the app will continue to operate to ensure people in Scotland may continue to travel internationally without issue?
Deputy First Minister.
Well, President Officer, as I've delicately explained to Mr Hoy in my answer, the app was originally designed for use for international travel, and we expect the app will continue to be required for that purpose until at least June 2023 to enable people from Scotland, just to repeat the point in case the Conservatives didn't understand it, to enable people in Scotland to be able to travel from Scotland to other countries and to be able to access venues in the way that countless other countries require individuals to demonstrate their COVID vaccination status to enable them to gain entrance.
Question number 5, Mercedes Vialba.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of any potential impact on its COVID recovery strategy of its decision to end the universal provision of lateral flow tests.
Deputy First Minister.
President Officer, our decision to transition from regular lateral flow testing for the general public is based on the latest available evidence and advice from public health officials and clinicians. Throughout the pandemic, the Scottish Government has made decisions based on expert advice, and we will continue to do so as we support recovery. Some groups will remain eligible for free lateral flow testing. This will include unpaid carers and personal assistants, people who are visiting a hospital or care home, and where it is advised as part of a clinical care plan. Alongside our evolving response to the pandemic, the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy will continue to focus effort and resources on bringing about a fairer future, particularly for those most impacted during the pandemic.
Mercedes Vialba.
I thank the Minister for that response. One of the stated aims of the Scottish Government's COVID recovery strategy is to improve access to services where provision was restricted by the pandemic. Though health and social care workers will continue to be able to access free lateral flow tests, other frontline workers, from teachers to hospitality staff, will no longer have access to them for routine workplace testing. This could lead to access to services such as schools and restaurants being disrupted, especially as Scotland's COVID infection rates remain high. So will the Scottish Government consider expanding access to free lateral flow tests to all frontline workers in order to ensure a fair and safe COVID recovery?
Deputy First Minister.
I understand the significance of the point that Mercedes Villalba raises, and particularly the point about access to services for people who had their access disrupted during the course of the pandemic. And I'm thinking particularly of individuals, for example, accessing day centres and other provision of that type, which I suspect lies at the heart of the question. What we have tried to do in recognising the fact that we are emerging from what I might describe as the intensity of the pandemic into a position where we are essentially managing the pandemic within the community and its prevalence, is to take a proportionate approach about the availability of lateral flow testing, so that where there is perhaps the risk of greater intensity of infection in healthcare settings, we enable that arrangement still to be applied. That will, of course, be an approach that we continue to review as we see infection levels in our society. And I think what is encouraging about the period just now is that although we've had a very intense period of COVID infection in our community, that is showing signs of consistent decline, which is very welcome for the forthcoming period.
A supplementary, Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you. Whilst it is welcome that testing remains free of charge to those who have health conditions, what consideration is the Scottish Government given to expanding the availability of free lateral flow tests to those who are close contacts to someone in the high-risk category, such as family members?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the principal measure we can put in place to ensure population-wide resilience is the vaccination programme. And of course, we've had phenomenal participation in the vaccination programme. And with the availability now of new COVID treatments, the reliance on the testing approach is not as significant as it was in the past. We are, as I've indicated, using lateral flow tests in a targeted way to support clinical care and to protect in high-risk settings. From the 1st of May, anyone eligible for COVID treatments, unpaid carers and anyone visiting a hospital or care home, it can still order lateral flow tests online or by phoning 119.
Question number 6, Jackie Dunbar.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of any potential impact on its COVID-19 recovery strategy of the reported costs of living crisis.
Deputy First Minister.
President, so the Scottish Government is acutely aware of the impact that increases in the cost of energy, food, transport and other essentials are having on people across Scotland, and we are taking immediate action to support those most impacted by the cost of living crisis. Our £290 million cost of living support package is supporting 1.85 million Scottish households. We're investing up to £113 million of additional investment through our Tackling Child Poverty Delivery Plan, and we have increased the value of a further 8 Scottish Social Security benefits. The key levers to address the cost of living crisis are reserved to the United Kingdom Government. The UK Government has repeatedly failed to take the steps necessary to address this crisis. I take this opportunity to urge them to either take the steps required to protect people or devolve the powers that allow this Government to take further action.
Jackie Dunbar.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for his answer. For many, this month's paycheck will be the first since the national insurance hike. This comes as energy bills skyrocket, and new research has revealed that folk face yet another hit, with the average food bill potentially increasing by a staggering £271 this year. Can the Deputy First Minister outline what steps the Scottish Government has taken to support households facing acute challenges from the pandemic and now a cost of living crisis of the Tory Government's own making? And does the Deputy First Minister share my view that Scotland's recovery would be best served if this Government had the full powers over welfare, energy and the economy that would come with independence?
Before I call on the Deputy First Minister to respond, I would urge that we stick to the question in the Deputy First Minister's response, which was to do with the COVID recovery strategy, amongst other things. Thank you.
Well, I do agree with the point put forward by Jackie Dunbar, and I would explain that the Government is taking a range of actions within the devolved powers that we have at our disposal and our limited resources to help people facing the current cost of living crisis. Through our cost of living support measures, spend on unique Scottish Social Security payments that are not available elsewhere in the United Kingdom, bridging payments and mitigating the bedroom tax, we are set to invest almost £770 million to tackle the cost of living crisis this year. That's an indication of a government engaged in addressing the cost of living crisis. I only wish the United Kingdom government would either engage in tackling the crisis or devolve the powers to enable us to do exactly that.
And supplementary, Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Yesterday we heard in the debate on MS week that it costs between £600 and £1,000 more to live with MS. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out what specifically the Government are doing to support disabled people to meet the extra fuel costs during the cost of living crisis?
And again, Deputy First Minister, if we could try to link this to the COVID recovery strategy, that would be really helpful. Thank you.
Well, there is a direct link to the COVID recovery strategy, Presiding Officer, in that at the heart of the COVID recovery strategy is the determination of the Government to tackle the inequalities that existed pre-pandemic, which I accept affect many individuals with disabilities, and which were exacerbated by the pandemic, hence my answer earlier to Mercedes Villalba as well. So the Government, in the COVID recovery strategy, that focus on tackling inequalities, the decisions the Government has taken to uprate benefits by a number of Scottish benefits by 6%, is a substantive contribution to assisting individuals, many with disabilities, who will access these benefits to be able to manage the significant challenges that households face. I don't in any way understate the significance of those challenges, which I recognise to be acute. I only wish the United Kingdom Government was contributing more to the process.
Question number 7, Pauline McNeill.
To ask the Scottish Government how its policies across government will support young people living in Glasgow to recover from the COVID-19 pandemic.
Deputy First Minister.
President, sir, we know that young people across Scotland have had an extremely challenging time during the pandemic, and the Scottish Government is committed to supporting all of our young people as we recover. Improving the wellbeing of children and young people is one of the central outcomes in our COVID recovery strategy, and together with partners in local government, business and the third sector, we are delivering policies that will help young people, including those living in the City of Glasgow. For example, as part of the Young Persons Guarantee, developing the Young Workforce Glasgow are working to support young people with additional barriers into positive destinations. Glasgow's local employability partnership is also prioritising supporting those furthest from the labour market to achieve a positive destination.
Pauline McNeill.
As the Deputy First Minister highlighted, young people between the ages of 18 and 24 have been at the sharp end of this pandemic, but are most likely to have experienced extended worklessness during it, especially those who shielded and gave up their jobs. Youth unemployment in Glasgow sits at 9%, so that's almost three times the national average. And young people who return to work are most likely than the average person to be in insecure work and not be in a union. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that more needs to be done to protect those young people in work, given some scandalous stories of poor treatment, not just in Glasgow, but across the country? And I could ask the Cabinet Secretary, how is the Scottish Government ensuring that young people in Glasgow, and in fact across the country, can access decent and secure jobs, but with the ability to develop good quality careers?
Deputy First Minister.
Fundamentally, I agree with the proposition put forward by Pauline McNeill, and I would contend the Government's agenda is designed to support that. The Young Persons Guarantee gives the assurance of a good pathway for every young person, no matter how far they are from the labour market. And indeed, in the COVID recovery work the Government is doing, we're placing special emphasis on making sure that we are able to reach those with the greatest challenges to get into the labour market. The Young Persons Guarantee provides that flexibility for some young people accessing further education or accessing some individually focused support may be what is required to enable them to overcome obstacles and to enter the labour market. But the assurance I would give Pauline McNeill is that we are, and I discussed this point with the Glasgow Economic Leadership Group, who I met just last Wednesday, who are very focused on making sure that the tremendous resource base in Glasgow of the talented young people, which if properly nurtured, supported and assisted, can contribute significantly to the city's economic recovery. And the Government is very committed to working with our partners in Glasgow to enable that to be the case.
Supplementary, Bob Dorris.
Presiding Officer, the Scottish Child Payment will clearly have a positive impact in supporting low-income families recover from the pandemic. Will the Deputy First Minister detail how many children in Glasgow are expected to benefit, and will the Scottish Government monitor that impact by surveying directly with those in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment to find out what they think?
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, we would expect around 50,000 children in Glasgow to benefit from the Scottish Child Payment in each of the next 5 years. We are currently undertaking an interim evaluation of the Scottish Child Payment. Of course, Mr Dorris will be aware of the fact that the Government has announced enhanced rates for the Scottish Child Payment in recent weeks as part of the Child Poverty Delivery Plan. And once the payment is fully rolled out to those responsible for children under 16, we'll carry out a full evaluation of the policy development. And both of these evaluations will involve engagement with those in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment to ensure that we capture the experience and the benefit for those individuals.
A supplementary, Murdo Fraser.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Young people in Glasgow and across Scotland will be sitting exams over the coming weeks, and a number of these young people may unfortunately miss their exams due to COVID. This is likely to lead to a large increase in the number of appeals going to the SQA over the summer. Is the Cabinet Secretary confident that the SQA are properly resourced to be able to deal with this likely increase in the number of appeals?
Deputy First Minister.
If this does result in an increased number of appeals, I am confident the Scottish Qualifications Authority will have the resource planning in place to enable that to be properly addressed.
Question number 8, Paul O'Kane, who is joining us remotely.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what assessment it has made of the potential impact on its COVID recovery strategy of its future plans for contact tracing.
Deputy First Minister.
Presiding Officer, the Test and Protect Transition Plan published on the 15th of March outlines the phased way in which Test and Protect will transition and support the effective management of COVID, primarily through adaptations and health measures that strengthen resilience and recovery as we rebuild for a fairer future.
Paul O'Kane.
I thank the Deputy First Minister for that answer. I've previously raised in the Chamber with both the First Minister and the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care the importance of ensuring that Test and Protect staff have their contracts honoured and are suitably redeployed so as not to lose their expertise and their knowledge from this period of the pandemic. As part of the recovery plan, I wonder if the Cabinet Secretary would agree with me that in learning from COVID-19, should we ensure that contact tracing systems are evaluated and refined to incorporate lessons learned, and should they be maintained within NHS so that they can be rapidly activated in future in case of further outbreaks, future epidemic illness or public health emergencies?
Deputy First Minister.
The first thing I'd want to say is to express my very warm thanks to the Test and Protect workforce, who I think have done an absolutely phenomenal job during the course of the pandemic in difficult circumstances. And in fact, when many of us were working from home, many of these individuals were working in very challenging conditions. So I record my warm thanks to those individuals. I agree with Mr O'Kane that it is important that we learn from the experience of the pandemic. It's part of building up the resilience as a population for the handling of any future pandemics. That is why the legislation that I'm bringing forward to Parliament is so critical in that respect, to make sure we have that pandemic awareness in place and the ability to handle those issues. And I think certainly there are arrangements that need to be put in place to make sure that learning can be built into the workings and the approaches of the National Health Service to enable us to be properly resilient for any future pandemics.
Thank you, Deputy First Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on COVID-19 recovery and parliamentary business. And I will allow a very short pause before we move on to the next portfolio questions to allow front bench teams to change places should they wish. Thank you. Thank you. The next portfolio is net zero energy and transport. I remind members that questions 1 and 7 are grouped together and that I'll take any supplementaries on these questions once both of them have been answered. If a member wishes to request a supplementary question, they should press the request to speak button during the relevant question or enter R in the chat function during the relevant question. And again, I appeal for succinct questions and answers to match. Question number one, Bob Doris.
To ask the Scottish Government what assessment has been made of the impact of rising energy costs and fuel poverty in the most deprived communities.
Cabinet Secretary Michael Marston.
We are doing all that we can within our devolved powers to support households, including through our £10 million fuel insecurity fund and expanded support to improve home energy efficiency. But only the UK Government has the powers over energy pricing and obligations necessary to fully address the cost pressures on households. Our analysis suggests that the increase in the energy price cap could see an additional 211,000 households moving into fuel poverty, representing a 43% increase from 2019. For the 15% most deprived communities in Scotland, the increase is estimated to be even greater, rising to some 54%.
Bob Doris.
Presiding officer, I have been contacted by community heat customers in Wynford Estate facing eye-watering price increases for heat and hot water with tariffs more than doubling. Whilst I have had a constructive meeting with SSE, the relationship between rising wholesale gas prices and additional costs for running community heating are absolutely unclear, and I have made specific suggestions to lower costs, including urging SSE to rethink the tariff increases. Will the Cabinet Secretary join me to urge SSE to do just that, as well as other community heat providers to show price constraint, given one of the underlying purposes for many heat networks, including in the Wynford and my constituency, was to tackle fuel poverty in the first place?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I am aware of the issue which the member has raised, and I can advise him that my officials have already met with the Senior Advice Bureau representatives on this very issue, and have also been in contact with SSE to raise the concerns about affordability and the debt amongst the community heat customers in Wynford. What I can assure the member of is that we will continue to press SSE to try and help to resolve some of these issues, but he will recognise that there are complexities to this matter, given the nature of the energy market and the fact that energy prices are largely being driven by, even electricity prices are largely being driven by the wholesale gas price at an international level. But what I would certainly wish to encourage the member and any of his constituents who are experiencing difficulty is that they should in interim contact Home Energy Scotland and they can provide them with advice and support going forward in order to try and help to support them in reducing their energy costs overall.
Question number seven, Fulton MacGregor.
Thank you, President Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to help people experiencing fuel poverty as a result of increased energy bills.
Cabinet Secretary.
We recognise the immense financial strain that households are experiencing as energy prices rise. Since the powers over the energy market are reserved, we are pressing for more action from the UK Government to help hard-pressed consumers. Meanwhile, we are doing everything we can within our powers to help. Through our £290 million cost of living support package, we are giving 1.85 million Scottish households £150 of extra support in April. We are also allocating a further £10 million to continue our fuel insecurity fund, which has been helping households at risk of severely rationing their energy use or self-disconnecting entirely since 2020.
Fulton MacGregor.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response. Increased energy bills means that many people in my constituency of Coatbridge and Creighton, and indeed across the country as a whole, are having to choose between heating and eating. Given that energy powers are largely reserved, as the Cabinet Secretary has said already, does he agree that the crisis demands immediate action from the UK Government and that cutting VAT on energy bills would be a simple and effective way to support people during this very difficult time?
Cabinet Secretary.
Officer, we've set out a range of measures which we believe the UK Government should take in order to help to avert the crisis that many households are facing and whether they can afford to heat or eat, given the very significant increase in energy prices which are being experienced and also the prospect of those energy prices increasing yet again in the autumn when the price cap is reviewed. One of those measures in the short term that the UK Government could take forward is to cut VAT on energy bills in order to try to help to reduce some of the pressure on household budgets, and we've urged them to do so. We urged them to do so in January, and we urged them again last month in order to look at taking action on this particular issue. It is important that the UK Government recognise the crisis that many households are facing with the increasing costs that they face, not just in energy bills, but across the cost of living in general, and that they respond to that in a way which is much more effective than what has been a severe lack of response to date.
A supplementary, Mercedes Fiaba.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Energy is not a luxury. People have to be able to heat their homes. That's why it's so important that we do everything that we can within our powers and resources to help people to do that. Those were the First Minister's words in this chamber last month. Labour-run North Ayrshire Council is tackling rising energy costs by pioneering publicly owned energy production. But we need to see this kind of ambition on a national scale. So will the Scottish Government look again at a model of publicly owned energy for the whole of Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
President Officer, I think the member makes an important point about the basic right to be able to heat your home and the fact that fuel poverty is one of the highest levels for the whole of the UK, largely because of the rural environment which we have. In relation to being able to operate a national a public energy company that could deal with production and also the retail element of it, the reality is, the member will recognise, is that you require to be effectively an independent country in order to do so. And the reason that you require that is because you need the powers to be able to borrow in the market in order to invest in the market. And secondly, you also have to have control. You also have to have control over the energy market in order to do so. That's why countries in Scandinavia have been very successful and effective in doing so. And that's why we believe that the best way in which we can control our energy use here in Scotland and our energy market in the future is by Scotland having full control over these issues and making these decisions right here in Scotland.
And supplementary, Beatrice Wishart.
How will the Scottish Government ensure sufficient funds are available to those who need insulation or replacement heating systems for their homes, especially those on restricted incomes or in rural and island areas with high levels of fuel poverty?
Cabinet Secretary.
Captain Officer, in three areas we are increasing our level of support given the experience that households are having at the present time with energy prices. One is expanding Home Energy Scotland's advice service, providing free impartial advice to households. They are seeing a 20% increase in the support that they can provide. We are also widening the eligibility criteria for the Scottish Government's Warmer Homes Scotland fuel poverty programme, which includes expanding that programme to more households, with those that are occupied by those between the ages of 60 and 75 years of age. And we are also increasing the level of funding for individual fuel-poor households through the area-based energy schemes as well. And alongside that, we are expanding our wider energy programme around insulation programmes for properties. So we are taking forward measures that we can in order to help to reduce people's energy costs, because the cheapest energy you get is the energy you don't use. And that's why we need to make sure that energy efficiency is a key part of our strand of work to help to not just reduce them in the short term, but in the medium to longer term as well, because it also helps to tackle our climate change challenge.
Question number two, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government what steps it is taking to make homes easier to keep warm in light of the need to tackle the reported cost of living crisis.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Government has allocated over £1 billion since 2009 to tackling fuel poverty and improving energy efficiency. More than 150,000 fuel-poor households have benefited from our investment. This year alone, we've committed a further £336 million to help make homes warmer and less expensive to heat as part of our £1.8 billion commitment over the course of this Parliament, which is the most ambitious programme within the UK. And last October, we published our Heat and Building Strategy, which sets out our commitment to addressing the dual challenges of reducing carbon emissions and tackling fuel poverty.
Gillian Mackay.
I thank the Minister for that answer. Does he agree with me that there is a stark contrast between the UK Government's approach to energy policy, which places all of its bets on expanding nuclear power and squeezing out even more oil and gas, while neglecting the much quicker and more significant impact that investing in energy efficiency can bring, with that of the Scottish Government, which is seeking to do everything that it can to ease energy costs for hard-pressed households?
Minister.
Well, I agree completely. There is a stark contrast between those two agendas. It's not just the different views there'll be in the chamber about whether expanding the fossil fuel industry in the midst of a climate emergency is viable, but the extraordinary decision of the UK government to publish not only a heat and buildings strategy, but also a UK energy security strategy, which don't put emphasis on energy efficiency and demand reduction. The Scottish Government is committed to placing a high priority on that. Scottish ministers wrote to the Secretary of State on the 18th of March, setting out wider views on energy policy, including the need to accelerate decarbonisation of electricity, which in part supports decarbonisation of heat and transport, reforming the network charging system, creating new business models for green hydrogen, as well as rebalancing policy costs to protect consumers. And as the Cabinet Secretary said in response to question one, we've also announced since March wider eligibility criteria for the energy efficiency upgrades and Warmer Home Scotland activity, as well as measures to ensure that the maximum number of people can benefit from our area-based schemes, including the focus on fabric-first insulation upgrades.
A supplementary, Brian Whistler.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The cost of heating homes using domestic heating oil has risen dramatically in recent months, even more so than gas and electricity. Given that the prominence of domestic heating oil is within rural communities, I wonder if the Minister agrees with me that both in terms of running costs and carbon footprint, homes which use domestic heating oil should be a priority for support to install low-carbon heating systems. And if so, how will the Scottish Government enable this to happen?
Minister.
I thank the member for the supplementary, and yes, this is a high priority, and I regularly see correspondence from members who are supporting constituents to access the wide range of support through not only advice but also grant and loan schemes that the Scottish Government provides to enable people to access not only energy efficiency measures in homes but also the switch to zero emission heating. And I hope that the member and members across the chamber will support their constituents to access that support.
Question number three, Douglas Lumsden.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on progress regarding the transport projects funded from the £254 million announced in 2016 as part of the Aberdeen City Region deal. And I'd like to remind members of my register of interest that shows I'm still a councillor at Aberdeen City Council.
Minister Jenny Colbooth.
In 2016, the Scottish Government committed to invest up to £125 million in the Aberdeen City Region deal, matched by the UK Government. Alongside the deal, the Scottish Government announced an additional £254 million of investment in the North East infrastructure. This includes £200 million to help improve journey times and increase capacity on key rail links between Aberdeen and the Central Belt, and £24 million for a new grade separated junction at the Lawrence Kirk A90 A937 South Junction. Now, the option selection process for the rail improvement project is nearing completion, and we expect to complete the project by the end of 2026. We also continue to push forward with the statutory process for the Lawrence Kirk Junction Improvement Scheme, and we're working with objectors to the scheme at the moment, which of course include Aberdeenshire Council, to try and resolve concerns wherever possible. Delivery of the scheme itself, though, can only commence if it is approved under the relevant statutory procedures, at which point a timetable for the construction phase can be set.
Douglas Lumsden.
Yeah, I thank the Minister for that answer. In 2008, the SNP first promised £200 million to reduce rail journey times between Aberdeen and the Central Belt, but no improvement has been made. Another broken promise by this SNP government, just like when Alex Salmond said the first decision he would make if he got elected as First Minister in 2007 would be to dual the road between Elland and Peterhead, with a decision being made within 100 days of him gaining office. Fast forward more than 5,000 days and the North East is still waiting. So when will this government stop the soundbites, stop breaking their promises to the people of the North East and start delivering on the commitments that they made?
Minister.
I thank Mr Lumsden for his supplementary question, Presiding Officer. I have to remind the member that in terms of broken promises, of course, six city deals right across Scotland remain shortchanged by Westminster to the tune of £420 million, or approximately £439 per household. This isn't levelling up. It's very clear the UK Government is not able to match Scottish Government funding. Now, in Aberdeen, as I've outlined, We've invested £379 million of funding from the Scottish Government, only £125 million from the UK Government. And this from the same Conservative Party who, of course, reneged on the carbon capture investment in the North East, which was promised to the people of the North East in 2014. The North East can certainly do better, so I'll take no lectures from Mr Lumsden in terms of broken promises. In terms of the Aberdeen to Central Belt, rail capacity increases by 2026, as I outlined. An additional £200 million will have been invested in increasing rail passenger and freight capacity between Aberdeen and the Central Belt, as committed previously by ministers.
Supplementary, Gillian Martin.
Thank you, President Officer. Does the Minister share my disappointment that the UK Government has failed to match £379 million the Scottish Government spends on city deals, resulting in a shortfall of £254 million, which is the equivalent of £1,125 for every household in the North East?
Minister.
Absolutely. I'm really disappointed that the UK Government has refused to even match our £500 million Just Transition Fund, despite, of course, the £300 billion that's flown to the Treasury from the North Sea in terms of our oil revenues since the 1970s. The future for the North East is a bright one, and I'm proud that we are putting our money where our mouth is when it comes to ensuring a just transition to sustainable energy and greener jobs with our £14.3 million skill investment to provide immediate training and enterprise opportunities for up to 3,000 people across the region. Good green jobs don't just happen, which is why on Monday of this week, the First Minister announced annual funding of £100,000 for the STUC to support officials who can liaise with workers and government to continue to influence and shape our delivery of a just transition.
Question number four, Pam Dungan-Glancy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the reported concern of taxi drivers in Glasgow that they may be forced to leave the profession unless further support is offered when low emission zones come into force.
Minister Jenny Ruth.
To help taxi drivers prepare for low emission zones, the Scottish Government offers grant funding towards the cost of retrofitting taxis to the latest Euro 6 standard through the Low Emission Zone Support Fund. Those grants provide up to 80% of the capital cost of retrofitting, which is capped at £10,000 per vehicle. From 2019 to 2022, the LEZ Support Fund has made over £5.5 million available to households and businesses, and a further £5 million is being offered by the Scottish Government via the LEZ Support Fund for 2022-23. I understand the challenge that the introduction of LEZs present to taxi drivers, and I have agreed to a meeting with taxi representatives and unions to discuss the matter further when a suitable date, and we're looking at the moment for a suitable date in the diary to do just that.
Pam Dungan-Glancy.
I thank the Minister for that answer, and the Minister will be aware that many taxi drivers in Glasgow have felt that this is not yet enough. Taxis provide employment as well as an essential service for people in Glasgow to get around, especially disabled people who cannot access other forms of transport. I am therefore deeply concerned that there are a limited number of second-hand taxis available to meet low emission standards. So what other specific action is the Scottish Government going to take to help drivers upgrade vehicles and ensure they aren't forced to spend extortionate or unreasonable amounts to purchase new ones, or worse still, forced out of the profession altogether?
Minister.
I thank Ms. Pam Dungan-Glancy for a supplementary question. As she outlined, I think the Glasgow taxi fleet consists of a significantly higher number of older taxis than perhaps other cities in the country, and that is in part due to Glasgow City Council licensing conditions that have been maybe less stringent than in other parts of the country. In terms of the support that we are able to provide, the Low Emission Zone Retrofit Fund that I've outlined gives up to 80% of grant funding. The Clean Vehicle Retrofit Accreditation Scheme, also approved solutions, offers as part of the LEZ Retrofit Fund, gives further opportunities to allow for taxis to retrofit either with new engines or exhaust to use LPG fuel, for example, or with new exhaust to the existing diesel engine. There's also the Low Emission Zone Support Fund, which is available to eligible micro-businesses. But as I've outlined in my response to Pam Dungan-Glancy, I'm meeting with taxi drivers and unions soon to discuss this in more detail, and we'll look at what more support we might be able to support in this place.
And supplementary, Co-Cab Stewart.
Thank you. The Minister will be as pleased as I am to see the low emission zone scheme for Glasgow agreed. I know the changes are going to be challenging for some, but they're also going to deliver significant benefits. Can she say how the scheme will help, for example, to improve air quality in Glasgow city centre, which is part of my constituency of Glasgow Kelvin, and what other impacts we can hope to see as a result of the lowering emissions in the city centre?
Minister.
I thank Co-Cab Stewart for her question. Of course, she's right to say this is not without challenge, but Glasgow's low emission zone has now been formally submitted to Scottish ministers through Transport Scotland, of course, for final approval, and Glasgow remains on track to introduce their scheme by the end of May. Forecasting has shown that the LEZs will significantly reduce harmful transport emissions in parts of the city centres where air quality really needs to improve. LEZs will also contribute towards meeting emission reduction targets and are part of a range of actions that we are delivering to make our transport system cleaner, greener and healthier.
Question number 5, Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government how many jobs in the forestry sector have been created as a result of the Scottish National Investment Bank.
Minister Mary McCallum.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. This information is not collected nor held by the Scottish Government. It's a matter for the Scottish National Investment Bank, who make independent decisions about what investments to make and what information to collect, monitor and publish about those investments. However, in August 21, the bank committed £50 million to Gresham House Forestry Fund. This investment is under 12 months old and has therefore not been subject to the bank's annual reporting cycle. However, it was estimated that it could sustain over 200 existing jobs and create 500 more in Scotland.
Rachel Hamilton.
The SNIB is to plough millions into forestry. However, there are issues over tree species and jobs. As the bank itself admits, 54% of those will be non-native. We know that the major flaws are associated with large-scale Sitka spruce plantations, especially with carbon sequestration and greenwashing. It's estimated only 200 jobs will be created. Not an impressive return for 50 million, which I believe has gone to Guernsey. And hardly a resounding success story for protecting rural communities. So can I ask the Minister why such a deal was signed off through SNIB when it has such a poor return for the environment, net zero progress, job creation and rural communities?
Yeah. Minister.
Presiding Officer, as I thought might be obvious to the member, the bank invests on a commercial basis alongside private money and it makes independent investment decisions that do not involve Scottish ministers. However, I am content that this particular investment rises to a number of the objectives of the Scottish Government, including carbon sequestration through commercial planting, support for biodiversity and the creation of good green jobs in our rural communities.
Supplementary, Paul McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy President Officer. My understanding is that investment like tree planting is generally a long-term endeavour and the bank has only recently been set up. Rachel Hamilton and the Scottish Tories should be aware that Scotland has a very positive story to tell regarding forestry. It's worth nearly £1 billion per year in GVA and employs over 25,000 people. So, can I ask the Minister how the forestry initiatives carried out under auspices of the SNIB will help to complement the Scottish Government's tree planting goals and support our drive towards net zero?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, I could hardly hear the question. However, this commitment to this forestry fund has been set up, as I've said, focusing on wide-scale new planting with an estimated carbon sequestration potential of a staggering 1.2 million tonnes of carbon. And as I've said, there are also commitments to biodiversity support and to sustainable forest management, both of which are in line with Scottish Government objectives. This year, for our part, Scottish Forestry will also set out research on the different sequestration potential of the planting of different types of woodlands, as well as the jobs which flow from these kinds of projects.
Question number 6, Faisal Chowdhury.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussion it has had with Transport Scotland, Network Rail, Winchborough Developments Limited and West Lothian Council relating to the provision of railway station at Winchborough.
Minister Jenny Goldruth.
Winchborough Developments Limited is responsible for the provision of a new station at Winchborough. Scottish Ministers and the principal funder of Winchborough Developments Limited met twice in 2020 to discuss the proposed Winchborough railway station. In 2021, there was one further meeting between the CEO of Transport Scotland and the principal funder of Winchborough Developments Limited. A meeting shortly with the local constituency MSP, Fiona Hislop, to discuss this. And I know that Ms Hislop has campaigned tirelessly for some time now. And I, like her, am keen to ensure that we all work together, including with the local authority and the developer, to make progress on this new station.
Faisal Chowdhury.
I thank the Minister for the answer. The people of Winchborough were first promised a railway station 15 years ago, but Transport Scotland would not let West Lothian Council make the station a condition of the development. We now hear, as a result, that there may be no station at all. Would the Minister consider visiting Winchborough with me to see her for herself the massive scale of development and the folly of a nation in declared climate emergency, forcing hundreds of new residents into cars and private transport.
Minister.
I thank Faisal Shadi for his supplementary question. I think it's important to remember, and it may interest the member, there are no cases of developer-funded stations in Scotland at the moment. I think there are at least two cases of developer-funded stations in England. But funding towards those new stations is requested through the Rail Enhancement Budget, and it's worth noting that the proposal for a station at Winchborough came from the developer, not from the government, along with their offer to fund the station itself, and this came at a much lower estimate cost in terms of the cost associated at the time. With regard to this offer of meeting, I've previously committed to meet with Ms Hislop. Let me first meet with Ms Hislop, and then I'd be more than happy to follow up on further detail with the member.
Supplementary, Sue Webber.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. The City Region deal for Edinburgh and South East Scotland was signed off by six local authorities, the UK Government and the Scottish Government. The deal included 5,000 new homes in Winchborough. Thanks to a West Lothian official, we know that Transport Scotland blocked an attempt to make the construction of a new station at Winchborough a condition for planning permission for the houses. With a hammer blow of taxes hanging over the families that choose to live in Winchborough but work in Edinburgh, will the Cabinet Secretary now prioritise funding for the station that will provide a genuine alternative to many than the car?
Minister.
I have to remind the member that this suggestion, this proposal, came from the developer. It did not come from Transport Scotland, nor am I aware of any Transport Scotland officials blocking this development from coming forward. I'm more than happy to, as I've outlined, I think, in my previous response, to meet with the developer to ensure that this comes to fruition. But this proposal originally came from the developer, who also committed to fund it.
And supplementary, Fiona Hislop.
Can I thank the Minister for agreeing to meet with me and point out that the Cabinet Secretary has previously visited Winchborough and seen the potential there. Winchborough is likely to grow to a similar size to Linlithgow. Linlithgow is one of the busiest stations in Scotland. And of course, the financial crash in 2010 did cause significant disruption to everybody, not least the development of Winchborough. I think there's a bit of rewriting of history in relation to what West Lothian Council could and should have done in regards to development. But does the Minister agree with me that the most sensible thing to do is to get all the relevant public bodies together? Network Rail has already indicated to me that there is possibility of driving the cost down from previous experience of building stations, and that actually creative solutions can and should be found, and that potentially the Edinburgh and Lothian City deal may be a vehicle to make sure that we can try and close the gap of the funding, because my constituents, most certainly who have bought their houses in Winchborough, deserve a station, but we all need to work positively and proactively together to make it happen.
Minister.
I thank Ms Hislop for her supplementary question. She's absolutely right. We do need to get all relevant parties round the table here, and we do need to look at creative solutions. So I give her that commitment. And with regard to the city deal itself, of course, as she mentioned, some of the kind of changing global priorities at the time, perhaps, of its inception. But the Scottish Government does recognise that those priorities can change, and we're always looking to discuss potential changes to the deal. Should partners, of course, this has to be about local authority partners, should they wish to propose them, provided they meet, of course, the associated eligibility criteria. And I would also note that the recent West Lothian Council Board notes state that the developer and the council will make an ask to Edinburgh and the City Region deal for a contribution towards the station.
And question number 8, Maggie Chapman.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on its engagement with the Campaign for North East Rail.
Minister Jenny Gilruth.
I'm due to meet with the Campaign for North East Rail and with MSPs at a meeting planned early in the summer to discuss their proposals. I'd also like to take this opportunity to thank the campaign group for submitting its response to the second Strategic Transport Projects Review consultation, which closed on the 15th of this month. All responses are now being considered, and these will help inform the final set of recommendations, which we plan to publish later in the year.
Maggie Chapman.
I thank the Minister for that response and for her acknowledgement of CNER's published response to STPR2 process. She will also be aware of the importance of connecting the towns of Peterhead and Fraserburgh to the rail network if these two towns are to benefit from and be a part of creating the new economy that the North East so desperately needs. Can the Minister give assurances that the Campaign for North East Rail's response will be included and that the campaign group themselves will be incorporated into design decisions for the next promised feasibility study so that local knowledge, local expertise can be taken on board to ensure the next study will take into account the needs of North East communities?
Minister.
Whilst, as a member will know, SEPR2 has not recommended the extension of a rail line to Elland and onwards to Fraserburgh and Peterhead as a strategic rail priority, I do recognise this may be, of course, a regional priority, and there remains, of course, a path for such rail projects to come forward. We saw that in my own constituency in 2019 with the Leavenmouth project, and that has to be, though, subject to a strong business case being developed and a suitable funding, of course, being identified. And any further work on that would be for partners to take forward. But I'm committed absolutely to meeting with those campaigners, plus MSP colleagues too, and we'll work with regional partners on any proposals for a rail link between Dyce and Elland and further north to Peterhead and Fraserburgh, if they decide, of course, to take that option forward.
And very brief supplementary, Liam Kerr.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Since 2016, I've been campaigning for new stations at Cove and Newton Hill, something the Campaign for North East Rail are also keen to see progress. Now, according to a recent study from Nestrans, most respondents in Cove and Newton Hill are in favour. So, now that the multimodal study has been published, can the Transport Minister tell me when Transport Scotland will issue its formal response and when the people of the North East will get the stations that they deserve?
Minister.
I thank Mr Kerr for his question. I don't have the detail of that in front of me, but I'd be more than happy to write with him with further detail.
Thank you, Minister. And that concludes portfolio questions on net zero energy and transport. And there will be a very short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you.